come here. Oh, quite a few of you. Just for Selenium Conf? Yeah. Perfect. Such a successful conference. And just to understand, how many of you work in organizations that are sized like 10,000 and more employees? 10,000 and more? How many of you are like 100 and less? 500 to 1,000. Okay. All right, I think we are on time. We can start. Okay. So hi everyone. We are going to talk something about user experience today and how it's going to help you. And for that matter, just like any other testing, the value of it depends on what is at risk. If there is nothing at risk, you might not test. But if there is so much on risk, you might want to test every aspect. The reason I was trying to figure out what is the size of the organization, a lot of times it's okay for a probably Google Glass to not fly off, it failed, or something, some device like that or some product like that doesn't work in a huge organization. But imagine a smaller product company, a startup, which has that one product to be launched and that doesn't fly. That doesn't work with the users. Users don't want to use that product. That's like a death warrant for the organization. And that's where user experience comes into, into play. Let's start with it. So before I get started with the actual, you know, the nitty-gritties of the actual user experience stuff as to what it is and how we do it, what are the usability lab studies and blah, 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 of all the technical details of it, let me share with you some observations I had, basis which maybe it will make more sense for you as to why you should understand user experience. So let me show you a couple of slides, screenshots, and anybody who's sitting behind who wants to look at the screen can come forward, because honestly I did not expect rooms to be this long. So quite a few of my slides I have changed last minutes. So bear with me with some images which look funny, but that's because I took out the text and put an image there for people to see. So if you are unable to see it, try to come forward. If it's still not visible, I'll help you with the slides. Okay. Anybody recognize this? Reddit? Yeah? This one? Amazon? This one? Craigslist? How pretty are they to look at? They aren't, right? I don't want to use the word ugly, but definitely nothing about them is very jazzy or beautiful to look at. How successful are they in their own fields? Yeah? They're the leaders in their own lines. So they did not, the idea was not to focus on their beauty. The idea was how to make the users adopt it more. So just to quickly give a small definition of user experience. Anyone wants to try here? What is user experience basis? As per them, what it is? Any definition? Any one-liner, two-liner? What is a word that comes to you, or a couple of words that come to you when you think user experience? How easy it is to use? Yeah, user-friendly. Okay. Yeah, user-friendly. How easy it is to use? Because the whole idea is to take the user from point A to point B. And how happy they are going there, and they are able to achieve their goals, right? The rest of the factors will come to that, but they're not as important as how the user is actually feeling about it. One of the other observations I had was users don't welcome change easy. And any of you who used to read Dig before Reddit, yeah? Yep. So Dig used to be hugely popular when Reddit started as a startup. Dig came up with Dig 1.0, super successful. Reddit was struggling to get the users. Then Dig came up with Dig 2.0, and something happened to the users. You know, there's a term called massive exodus. You know, when the wild buffaloes leave the summer time place and they run towards water because it's a matter of survival. So the huge tribe, the entire tribe just moves on. Something like that happened. People moved on from Dig to Reddit. How many of you are direct Facebook users, and how many of you are like transcending from Orkut? Anybody here who used to use Orkut? Me too. Yeah? What happened when Facebook came in? We just forgot there is something like Orkut. There was something like Orkut, right? Technically, probably they were all backed up with all good big organizations. There's nothing that was a technology failure. Let's look at eBay. Most any of you who attended the visual testing session in the morning, we had that discussion. But I'll just, for others who have not attended, let me just say. Users resist change, as we are talking about. And way back when eBay had started, they had this yellow screen. Microsoft, Google, all of them started to come in. And they all had those, you know, huge white screen. Remember Google search, just a bar, done. So people, and it got hugely adopted. If you'll remember, do you know where Google started? Even as a search engine, it started as number 12 and where it is today. So we'll talk more about the focusing part of it, but coming back to the topic of white screen, the technology heads of eBay decided to have white screen. And when they did, back then the emails were not very popular, or contact us, customer support, these things were not hugely popular. So the technology teams there used to get hate mails, you know, those handwritten mails saying, why did you change it? That's where they decided that they did want the change, the team did want the change, but the users did not. So they had to fool the user a little bit. They wrote an algorithm to tone down the screen, the color of yellowness, I mean the yellow color, one shade at a time, week by week, week by week, and by the end of the year, it was totally white. And the users were like, okay, they never complained, and the management work got done. Yeah, so that's how you have to treat users. You have to be sensitive to their need for not change so much. How many of you see Facebook trying so many things every now and then? Yeah, there's something called as A/B testing that they keep doing. I don't know if the statistics is very, very correct, but it's said that in a year, they approximately do about 25,000 A/B tests at any given point, like putting together. Okay, so here's another observation. Though eBay did fool their users, but the idea is to not make your users feel stupid. Make them feel smart that they're able to use the application right away. I'll show you an example here. Now tell me, which one is a salt shaker and which one is a pepper? The right one is? Right to yours? Right, yeah? Is salt? Pakka, sure? Huh? We'll try it. Okay, I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. But I always say, what's the problem in being simple and transparent to the user, that this is what it is. Now, until last time when I presented this slide, nobody questioned me on this, but there was a point which was a little bit valid, not 100%, but the point was, looks do matter to some point. I mean, this one does look more classy than that one. However, if I, but this time I got an answer for that. Last time I did not have an answer for that thing. This time I have the answer, and that is, do you recognize this? Have you seen this anywhere? Yeah. Here, on this breakfast, I absolutely love the design. I'm like, it looks classy, it doesn't hurt the user, it doesn't make the user confused, doesn't, like they don't feel like I don't know what is in it. And yet it's so simple, it's just single hand use. You don't have to keep pressing, shaking it. It's so easy. Okay. Another observation was that a lot of apps, software, they want to be intuitive. They want to use the familiar trends. So for one of the greatest examples of it was the hamburger menu. The moment it came in, most of the people, like, they just shifted to that because it was so familiar, so easy, the users were used to using it. Yeah. So all of this put together, these observations, what we realized was, what matters really is the usability. So what is usability? And this had a lot of text, I just made it into this design, so please excuse me. What is usability per se? It is how quick can you actually learn the application? How quick can you, once you've learned it, how efficiently you can use it? if you've been away from that application for say a couple of days, weeks, months, whatever, and you want to use it again and you come back, how easy it is to kind of memorize again how it was to use. If you do, as a user, if you do happen to conduct some errors on it, how much of criticality is allowed? Like how many critical errors are allowed? And if they do happen, how quickly can the user be back to their, you know, normal state? And at the end of it, overall satisfaction. How does the user feel good? How many of you use Paytm? Oxygen. MobiQuick. Yeah? There we have the difference. What's working, what's not. It's not about the technology, it's not about any other thing. Paytm, yes, you can say that, but MobiQuick wasn't very far away. And for that matter, what is that term, the first mover advantage? Yes, that's there. But sometimes it's also about, even if the second person has come in and they're solving the problem in a more neat way. Yeah, Google, which was a 12th search engine, is now number one. Yeah. So yes, I do agree with you that first mover's advantage was there with Paytm maybe, but it's definitely about being more neat and being more close to the users. So just to put in a context for you, if we look at UI, this is what it is, what is the best looking thing. Then there is the UX, how do users actually use it? And then there is the actual usability. How do the users actually are going to use it? So at this point, let me just quickly ask you, what is UI and then what is UX? UX we discussed, so how is it different than UI? Are they same? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is about the visual part of it. I am sorry, can you read it a little bit? Let me just help you out. You don't have to read each one of them, but the whole idea is UI is actually a little bit more on the interface design, the visual part of it. However, when we talk about UX, there is so much more. Starting from the very point, if somebody says, when do we start thinking about UX? It's at the point when you're talking about the concept itself. When you have not yet even reached the design, when you're just thinking that something like this, some service, some product like this should exist, that's the point where you start doing user experience, because that's where you need the voice of customer, you need all those kinds of marketing research done at the start. And then you come to the design and everything. So all kinds of information architecture, how should be the interface design, how should be the content laying on it, all of this. And we'll come to those elements of UX. But it is so much more, and it starts way early than what we think about it with respect to UI. Now, let me take you to the elements of user experience. So there is this front end, and then there's this huge back end which needs to be managed, which actually constitutes the UX. Okay, I'm hoping. So anyone here who can tell me what is HCI? Human computer interface, yeah? So going by the laws, and we'll quickly study a couple of laws of HCI also, but if it is a web app or a mobile app, this is how you need to actually design the user experience. Way before you actually see the front end of the application, there is so much more. You understand the user needs, what are the objectives of that site, what are the goals of the users, so there is one part where you are more focused on the functional specifications and the interface design. And then on the web, because it's more like a discovery platform, the web part is more like a discovery platform, you have to place the content much better, the content is requirements, the information architecture, where it is going to be placed, the navigation design, so overall the information design, how are you going to put the, which information is going to be placed where, how do you navigate through those. Those designs are there. And on top of all of it, then there is the visual layer. So visual layer is what we see, but how a user transcends through the application is what the user experience counts. User experience means. Now, before we go further into how we do the usability lab studies and everything, a quick exercise for all of you. And your time starts now. Pick any object, and in 40 seconds, just think, and it has to be in this room. Pick any object you like and think of an alternative use, not the typical use that you would think of. Chair, table, pick anything. And give me an alternative use of it. As many alternative uses you would like to think. 20 more seconds. Yeah, you can just think. We'll just ask for many people right after 20 seconds. Just think about it and anyone can share. Okay. All right. Tell me. Anyone? Yeah? To poke? Yes, so pen is used for writing, but you just thought of poking it. Anybody else? Yes. For trimming your beard? So you're using it as a mirror, the phone, camera lens, brilliant. The water bottle, how do you want to use it? You can cut the top part of it, of the water bottle probably, and then use it as a pen holder, yeah. See, the uses of a product can be multiple. It depends on what is it best fit for. What is the user actually looking at? The moment the user looks at the product, what are they wanting to do with it? Okay, so let's understand the building in depth. So one of the things that we need to understand is, how many of you think there is a sure shot way of building an amazing UX, amazing user experience? No, right? But there are ways you can make it effective. There are ways you can actually build for an amazing UX. Whether it happens or not, you will only get to know as a feedback, and then you have to keep improving. But if we look at a typical user experience process, we have to just build for it, and then let's see how it goes. Now this whole process, I'm going to divide it into two. One is when we are all planning for it, building an application, and I mean this whole process of building it. And then we'll actually dig down into the testing part of it. So the steps for building steps to build for amazing UX, and why I'm stressing on this is because there is no secret sauce which can say, okay, this will help you do that. There are some guidelines, some principles, and we'll quickly look at them. Narrow, build, test, collect, and simplify. What that means is, narrow down your user base. Who are you targeting? What's your target user when you're building a product? So even as a tester, how many of you are actually a tester here? Most of you? Yeah? So as a tester also, you should know who's going to use this product. Yeah? What's the target user? What that does is, if we do this initially, well before you've got into the design phase and, you know, creating the product, it helps your marketing team because then they know which platforms to market it. It helps the test team to understand what is the perspective for testing. It helps the dev team to know what is the must do, the very initial part, so that, because the process is going to be longer for building the whole product, but what is to be built first can be understood if you know your exact target users. Just to give you a quick example, certain examples. What do you think Amazon does today? Anything? Is there anything they don't do? Okay. Google. Is there anything they don't do? Yeah. But where did they start? Amazon used to sell books, old books or new books? Only new books. Amazon never sold old books, only new books. That's where this started. Which is the other example? Twitter. Where did it start? It was an SMS service. Where is it today? Very different, right? So the whole idea is that you may want to become very huge. You may want to become Google. You may want to become Amazon. Maybe your product is really huge. It's supposed to do 200 different things. But let's narrow down the initial set of target users. Let's know that we are first a search engine, or if you're selling the first set of books, what are we first going to do? And then once the adoption of the product increases, you can increase on as many features as you want. And that actually does save a lot of money. After you have narrowed down your target users, let's define your product. What does that mean? I'm going to define one and I'm going to let you define another. So let's say if I had to define a product and say this podium is a table-like item that allows a speaker to keep their laptops and stuff there to be able to speak. So I am mentioning here what the product is, and I'm trying to relate it to another product which is more relatable, and then I'm trying to define who is going to use speakers. You can say teachers, you can add more adjectives to those kind of target users. And then for what purpose? What is the use case? To speak, to keep the laptop, to keep their mobile phones, to have water there, to hide behind it if I'm not very comfortable. So whatever is the actual use of it, yeah? Now, if you can pick any product here, and I would really encourage you to, you can pick the OHP, you can pick a laptop, you can pick a chair, table, something, and give me one, just some kind of fill in the blanks for this. Let's say a chair or a table, whatever you want to pick. Pen is like pencil, something like that. If anybody wants to try, too shy? All right, then we'll move forward. But did you understand, give it a try, but did you understand? If you are able to define your product in a very specific term with something that you can relate to, with your target users added to it, so you exactly know what you're trying to build, who you're trying to build it for. And that's very important at the early stage. So you know how you can design it. Once you know your target users, once you know what kind of product you're trying to design and build, let's define your personas. What is a persona? More like a personality of somebody, yeah? So at the initial stage, it's okay for you to say this podium is required for speakers or teachers or something like that. But then at a later stage, when you actually come down to the features, that exactly how the navigation should happen, from which button, which all are the key menu items and sub-menu items, and what are the key features, at that point in time, you do need a very specific, to the point where you should be able to point out that this is my user because it fits the persona. What that means is you have to understand the demographics of it, of the user, where they come from, whether they come from North India, South India, Brazil, South Africa, US, which part of the, and more precisely, like, and then there are, whether they are from urban place, rural place, where do they actually come from. As a teacher also, as a speaker also, there could be some speaking at a very high level marketing kind of conferences, and then there will be some as at a very small meetup level of speakers. So when you're talking about a speaker or a teacher for a podium, you have to know who that teacher is, whether they are teaching in Bihar somewhere, or whether they are teaching in Chhattisgarh somewhere, whether they are teaching in the US, North Carolina somewhere. But you have to know who that speaker is. You have to know the behaviors of them. You have to know how their day-to-day goes. What are their key challenges? If you understand how they spend their day, how they spend their money, how they spend, depending upon what your product is, if you understand the goals of theirs, of their life, of their work, of their free time, you will be able to better support. If it was for a flyer, if I was building a application for an air ticket, I would probably focus on high frequent flyers, and depending upon which region we are into, so we would focus on to that, how frequently they fly, whether they are more incentivized with is this user getting more incentivized with a point system or a reward system, or do I give them cashbacks? What kind of things work with those people? What is their key need? Is it being on time? Is it being able to carry a lot of luggage? What kind of, flyer is that person? Is it a family flyer? Is it a business flyer? So those kind of things help me to understand how should I design my interface and what should be there, for him to navigate? What features should be there for him to quickly book his ticket? Because for me, the goal is selling that ticket. So how quickly I'm able to bring them from the login to the selling. Once you have built all of that, we have all the user stories, the user boards, and then you have to look at them and probably define how exactly this user is going to go through the whole process from start to end. And once you've gone through it, you need to build it, build as per the user stories. And how many of you work for startups here? Lot of you. So this would mean a lot of sense to you that speed is king. Yeah. If you're not building quick, if you're not coming out with a lot of iterations, if you're not covering the key pain points of the user quickly, then you're out of market because there are so many competitors out there. So you have to build it. I'll just come back to this slide, but before that, okay. So once you build your application, you have to then simplify it. Okay, so once you have those storyboards, those long trees and branches and all of them, let the user navigate and see which are the trees and branches where the user is never interested in going by all by themselves. They need a lot of, you know, stimulator to go there, persuasion to go there. And those are the areas you don't want in your application maybe. So you have to cut down those long trees and branches. You have to identify the dead ends. You have to identify how many steps you have in between to cover it. So between start to making payment, the number of steps should be really as low as possible. And redundancies and silos. So how many of them are like just sitting in a corner, some kind of menu item that you've just kept in a corner and nobody ever goes there. Coming back to tools, we will talk a little bit more on tools, but just to give you a high level idea, these are the tools. When you're building, you could use Kinotopia, HTML5, or any of those designs. And for prototype, you can also use I'm trying to recall a couple of more names, and I'll get to them as we go through. But once you've built a prototype, there's also a prototype called a tool, which helps you do the prototyping. Visualizer, anyone of you have heard of Visualizer? That allows you to actually, but that's more on the testing side. Once you've built a prototype, you can share it with the users. So to distribute, once you've built something and the building part is over, you want to distribute it for your users to use, Visualizer is one. Test flight is a huge one that really allows you to build it, to test it. When you have to collect analytics, so once you're done with building, once you've done with testing and it goes to the user, and now you want to see how many users actually use it from the start to end, and what is their point of drop, what is the point where they spend maximum time, what is the point where they're struggling back and forth. So a lot of such analytics are there, which get collected with Google Analytics or Heap. Yeah. Anyone here who knows what MVP is? Minimum viable product. What does that mean? Yes. The smallest to solve some problems. Smallest, easiest thing, a small part of software to solve a problem. Right? That is important. So what actually the whole basis of any kind of such tests and efforts are, you have to be able to do something, any kind of development, into the least cost, least time, with best quality. And when you are under this pressure, you want to first come out with an MVP and see if it's going to fly with the users. What is the kind of feedback you receive? Basis those feedbacks, you keep on moving in your product cycle. Now, when you are at this stage and somebody asks you to build a pizza in the lowest cost, and you come out with, you take the least cost, you take the least time, yeah? So because you have to really deliver it quick, and we have talked about speed being the king and everything, and you come out with this. Yeah? This is a burnt pizza. When I serve this to my users, to my customers, they're not going to like it. They're not going to accept it. And the feedback that I am going to collect is, my customer doesn't want pizza because they're not taking those pizza, right? Whereas that's so wrong. My customer wants a good pizza, an edible pizza. They don't want a burnt pizza, right? So when we are talking about the minimum, that minimum has to be good enough to solve the problem. The minimum cannot be so minimum that even it doesn't even solve the problem, and the users don't even adopt it at the initial stage. So it has to come to some point to be able to be called minimum viable product. It has to be viable. Fair enough? Okay, very quick look on the basis of HCI laws. How much time do we have? 15 minutes, that's too long. Okay, we'll then quickly run through this one. There are 5 human-computer interface laws basis which the user experience is formed. You do not have to take these as the set. These are just guidelines and principles. There is no giving that do this or do not do that. The Miller law says at one time do not give a user more than 7 plus minus 2 activities to do. Fitts law says that it takes users longer to point to links and buttons on a screen if the objects are smaller. So if you have anything that's key you want the user to use, keep it right in their face. This is what you have to use. Anything which is not so important could be away. Keystroke modeling, level modeling is one of the ways to which is based on that law. Peek-Hyman law is based on the number of choices, so do not have 20 choices on top. Probably you can go deeper, because at every stage number of choices, the users drop 50% of the choices. So if you need them to reach some point, you can't have 10 menu items. Probably you can have 5, let them go step by step down, because they can keep reducing the numbers in the vertical way. Power law of practice. The more you use the application, the more the lesser time you take to get used to it. Pareto and Zipf laws, this is funny but probably true, that the most used term in an application is twice as much as the second most and thrice as much as the third most. So if you're using some terms, you have to be like, okay, this is the most familiar word. If this is the term you want to use more, then it has to be really frequently available on the application. We'll skip the refrigerator, but how many of you do think that refrigerator has changed its design over a period of time? Yeah? How did it used to be? Single door, went to double door, went to vertical double door, went to 3 doors. Yeah, there are a lot of changes. Why did this happen? Because of a lot of user feedback. The ergonomics, economics, user adoption, everything comes together and gives a feedback for user experience. Yeah, that's how the designs change. And the basis of all this, how do you actually get these feedbacks from the user? Is the usability lab, different kind of studies, but yes, few of them are lab studies, few of them are field studies. So when we look at 3 different types of studies that we can do, one is moderated, wherein I invite specific users. I know that these are the 5 users who are definitely going to use my product. I invite them to my office and I see how they use the application. We moderate that, we record this whole process, we give them questionnaires, we build tasks for them to execute, we note down how quickly they are going through it or not going through it, what are the kind of failures, which are the steps not performed, which are the tasks not completed, and we do an analysis of all of that. Then there is a remote usability testing, where it is moderated, but it is remotely done through Skype, through GoToMeeting, screen sharing, any of them. And then there is unmoderated remote usability testing. Beta testing is one of those forms where, you know, these products, they come up with a new feature and they just throw it to the users, that they're not moderating you, it's remotely done, but you are testing it for them. You give the feedback, it's good, it's bad, I'm highly likely to use it, I'm less likely to use it. All those kind of feedbacks that you fill come through here. One of our India-based platform, 99 tests. How many of you know that? 99 tests, yeah. It's a brilliant application, brilliant platform to do any kind of unmoderated remote usability testing. It's done through, remote participants recording what they're doing, but there are a lot of tools which are used, including eye tracking, and we'll just come to those. We'll talk about that quickly. The moderating techniques that we have, either the user, the participant who's actually going through it, can think aloud, and while they're doing it, can speak about it. So we request the participant to do that, or it's like retrospective probing or concurrent probing. So either you, the user or the participant keeps talking about it during the process, or we let them talk about after it, or we ask them questions during it is happening, and we or we ask them questions later on. So it all depends upon what process will work better. There are pros and cons to look at them. Moderating tools. So these are the tools that we were talking about. There are tons of them. We'll go through a couple of them, but majorly when you are trying to do it remotely, it comes to Skype, GoToMeeting, and I'm sorry I have not kept 99 tests here, but it, I came across it. It was a good platform. If you want to do prototyping and testing, then Loop is good, Visualizer is good. If you want to do analytics, once it's built and you want to work on analytics, you can look at Crazy Egg, you can look at Heap, you can look at Google Analytics. If you want to just look at it from a static platform, you can actually go to Usabilia, very good tool, or Verify. Different methods of capturing the UX. Is this visible to all of you? So we have different methods of capturing UX some of them are capturing the behavior of the user, some of them are capturing the attitude of them, some of them are qualitative, and some of them are quantitative. So qualitative is more direct. It says, you know, I don't like this, I like this. This is work, that did not work. Quantitative is so many people used it, so many people did not use it, but we don't know exactly what, you know, why. The qualitative kind of feedback gives you more the whys of it. So we have usability lab studies, ethnographic field studies. Ethnographic field studies is where you have people from different demography and you throw this application to different people and look at them, how they are using it basis their demography. Usability lab studies are the moderated ones. The moderated in office kind of tests. Eye tracking is where you use a device or something to capture how the movements of eyes are happening. Usability benchmark is, it can be done in lab or it can be done in field, where they are actually looking at the competitors and other products and then matching how the user is over a period of time improving their use of the application. Moderated remote usability we spoke about, unmoderated we spoke about. Unmoderated remote panel studies is when you have experts on the subject and you send them the application for testing. Then we have clickstream analysis, A-B testing, which we'll talk, both of them. Unmoderated UX studies, we understand. True intent studies is a very, at a huge number, done at a huge size with a lot of people to just understand how the application is actually working with the what is the application meant for, and then what is the user using it for, just to map the intents. We'll go in detail about those which are specific for testing and evaluation. So there are a lot of studies which can be used for building, for design at different stage of product development. There are different studies we are doing, but we are only going to talk about those which are being used at the testing phase right now, though it goes on throughout. Card sorting. Now it's a way of testing the design. What we do is we know all the features that we are wanting to build in the product. We put them together, which are more likely to kind of look like they are part of a group. We put them together and then we put a name on the on the menu. So the menu is not decided, but the features are. So we are able to sort them out to build a application flow. Tree testing is where the menus are decided, but you actually go through, you look at the menu and you say, okay, which are the features which will actually fall into these kind of menus? You do that. Voice of customer surveys, you can do that by sending emails, doing market surveys, pop up on websites. Any website you stay for over 3 to 5 seconds, you'll get a pop up which will ask you to sign up for a newsletter. Keystroke modeling, what it does is it looks at how much time, like I have a machine, I do a keystroke and there is a time gap where the machine reacts to it and then I go further. And then once the machine has reacted, I go to the next keystroke. So how much time a man takes to actually do the keystroke and how much time the machine takes to react to it. And then we take on from there that how does the flow work there. all the mental operating time also is taken care of. Now, A-B testing. A-B testing is more like when you build multiple landing pages. So if you are a user from North America, probably you land on a different kind of design and different landing page, different kind of features. If you are a user from India, you will probably land on a different kind of page. It could have influence on languages, it could have influences on design, choice of colors, a lot of things, and features also. So that is A-B testing. When we do it, we choose our users, let the users go through different option A, option B screens. And if you see, option A gives 18% conversion to the goal page, option B gives 12% conversion to the goal page. What that means is, obviously, option A has a more chances of success. So we choose that as our landing page there. Then we have click testing. So this is a business user of Yelp who is trying to understand as to how can I merge my personal account and a business user account. So what we do there is we look at how the user is going through the application. The red ones are all those who are missing it, who are unable to reach there. So look at the percentage. We go from support center to your Yelp business user account. From there, only few of them are actually able to update their business page and go to the specific business ID. Rest of them go to a different page, and then a couple of them probably land up into their FAQs, going at different pages, which means that all those people are missing on where to click and reach the point. So they have not been able to fulfill their goals. Yeah. On ground, probably we can skip this if we need. You have to define your goals. You have to define the format, whether it is going to be in lab or moderated, unmoderated, all of them, how many users you want. If it has to be in lab, you can only do so many, 5, 10, 20. If it has to be in field, you can do so many of them remotely. Recruit right participants, because sometimes the attitude of the users are not good enough. They're not open to discuss. They're not open to share. Then the whole idea of doing the part goes for a toss. Right tasks, what they have to perform, then do a pilot study if it's working good. Determine the metrics and measurement, and then write the test plan. So metrics and measurement, what is your goal, what you want to measure, whether it is about task completion, whether it is about error-free stuff. I'm going to skip this in the interest of time because I do. These are the sample metrics when we come to user experience. Now these could differ for different kind of applications. But for example, in e-commerce, maybe order drop, address page drop, point of exit, a lot of different kind of metrics would come into play, but these are typically the kind of metrics. How many tasks were successfully completed, how many were not attempted, how many were attempted but failed, how many were just quit, they exited it, things like that are metrics for user experience. Few tools to use. We've discussed Google Analytics. It gives you your user, real-time users. It gives you how many people visited you, what kind of conversion happens through your organic marketing, organic users are coming in, how many are coming through some campaign that you are doing. So how many users are coming in, what time they are spending there, what is the kind of sessions. During those sessions, how many of them get converted into a customer. A lot of good analytics, which actually tells you if your product is working or not. That helps here. Pony Visualizer, as I talked about, it's at a prototyping level. And it gives you, it's like you build some screens. They are not even fully functional, but they're connected to each other. You can actually play it as a real app for the testing purposes. Loop, again, it's more like how many tasks were completed, how many were not completed kind of stuff. But once you have given some tasks and you are actually headed towards a very formal kind of user testing, this is a very good tool to use. Test flight. How many of you have used TestFlight? Yeah, what it does is it allows you to download the application, yeah, the latest version, and just test it there. They also mention the goals. So as you know, you have those release notes for each application. They mention what are the changes, what is to be tested, and you have certain like 90 days period to test it and give the feedback. Eye tracking tools. Much like this, but the whole, and I'm sorry, this screen will be, there's so many of eye tracking tools that are used. The whole idea is they would either be dependent upon the, 2 minutes? Yeah. Okay, so webcam or infrared kind of, what is tracking, how is actually the device tracking the eyes, eye movements. So it's either done through webcams or infrared devices. There is some of them provide real-time recording of what is happening. Some of them also do data analysis. There is some ongoing support. So basis different features, there's so many tools you can actually use to do the user's eye tracking, which actually helps you in understanding how this user is actually using the application real time. At the end of it, you have to look at the trends, you have to look at what are the errors which are constantly happening, which are the patterns. Almost all the users will have a certain kind of pattern where they are either going right or they are going wrong in certain direction. How many of them are, look at the kind of errors. Are they very critical in nature? Are they not so critical? Are they serious in nature? Are they simple in nature? Look at them, and that's what it is. Now, I did want to talk about this, but I am there around where I have myself goofed up a good amount of time building Pool Wallet, and then we finally went on to Fandoro, basis a lot of user experience feedback that we got. So we were a gifting application where we wanted users to actually do NGO donations, but we allowed them for commercial gifting and NGO donation, and we kept highlighting our vendors, and at the end of the day we realized that our user doesn't even connect with us because there are so many kinds of activities we talk. We were like wanting to be everything at once. There's so much of commercial gifting, NGO donation, you can party with your friends, you can do pooling together and gift something. That's when we narrowed down today as Fandoro, where we only do, there are some commercial parts, but we do not talk about it. It's only about individual social responsibility. And the moment we use this word, individual social responsibility through meaningful gifting, and we hit all our users, suddenly our adoption rate increased, suddenly our users were not confused about what is to be done on this platform. And there was huge adoption. So that was a case study I wanted to talk in detail, but we can do it when I'm around, if you guys are interested. I can share my failures at Pool Wallet and success at Fandoro both with you. That's all. Thank you so much.